My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away.
Hello, I'm the Dark Master, and in today's video, we shall be covering perhaps the most infamous species of moth to ever exist, a creature that has been responsible for a literal invasion throughout the United States of America, leaving wide areas of forests nearly completely deforested and many suffering severe pain. Listed as one of the top 100 worst invasive species on the planet, the one, the only, the Gypsy Moth. But what exactly is a gypsy moth, and where does it fit in the broader family tree of life? Well, first, we gotta go back to a reasonable starting point. Lepidoptera, the group that includes butterflies and moths, that it itself diverged from their caddisfly relatives in the early Jurassic 200 million years ago. This group itself is divided into five suborders. First of these suborders was the very small, both in size and diversity, group known as the Zeuglopterans, which are distinguished by maintaining chewing mouthparts into their adulthood, as opposed to a proboscis that other mortarhibes group have instead, having abandoned that in their evolution. Fossils of this group are known from the Middle Jurassic. Then there is the even more obscure Aglossala, also known as the Cory moths, which are a group of basal moths that split off in the middle to late Cretaceous and are only known from Australia and have two living species. Then there is the Heterobathami, which are again another basal group of lepidopterans that are relatively small. They are metallic day-flying moths confined to what is now the southern half of South America, where the species feed on the southern beaches of the genus Nothofagus. Then we have perhaps a suborder you know most about, the Rhopalocera, you know, aka the butterflies, which are beautiful moths that have become diurnal and super diverse, emerging sometime in the end Cretaceous and diversifying in the following Cenozoic. But it is in the fifth suborder that we see the relatives of the gypsy moth and what are relevant to the rest of this video. This last suborder being the Glossata, which includes everyone else. If you think of a moth, it's likely one of these guys, and they are distinguished from the other groups by a coilable proboscis. It is itself divided into six infraorders, which we shall briefly cover in a manner that, you know, we just did before. First, there are the obscure and small basal infraorder Acanthotursa, also called the archaic sun moths, which are tiny and poorly known. Then there are their Neoseptina, also called archaic bell moths, which are known from South America and Southeast Asia, which are even less known than the previous group we discussed. Then there are the Lophoconina, which contains a single genus of small basal nocturnal moths restricted to what is now Australia, though relatives are known from late Cretaceous-aged Burmese amber in Myanmar. Then there is the infraorder Daconifa, also called sparkling archaic sun moths. They are small metallic moths native to large portions of the northern hemisphere. They fly during the day and emerge fairly early in the spring. Their larvae are leaf miners of birch and oak trees. We then get to Exoporia, which are a much larger group, often referred to as ghost moths and swift moths, which are distinguished by the females possessing an external groove where sperm is transferred to the eggs. The last group are the ones that are going to be relevant to this video going forward. The heteroneura, which contains the remaining moths and are characterized by wing veneration, which is not homogeneous. It is itself divided into two groups. First as well, the small and obscure moth group known as Montiricia, which possess a single opening for both reproducing and laying eggs. One of the most noteworthy species in this group are the longhorn moths, so named for their long, horn-like antenna. The second group is the far, far larger of the two, the Ditricia, which are distinguished by how the females have two distinct openings, one for mating and the other for laying eggs. This group, in and of itself, is divided into two main groups, a paraphyletic collection of basal lineages called micromoths, which include the obscure Simiotheostia, Gracilioidae, and Yponitunidae, as well as more well-known species like the bagworms of the Tenioidae and the twirler moths of the Gelechionidae. The Apodistria are the second and larger group, which itself is divided into two groups. The first is a collection of basal superfamilies, which includes a wide variety of moths that people are relatively familiar with, including the burnet moths of Zygainoidea, the carpenter moths of Cossioidea, and the clearwing moths of Cyzioidea. There are the metal moths of Corutoidea, the leaf roller moths of Torchwickioidea, the plume moths of Pteroforoidea, the false plume moths of Aluctioidea, the fringed tufted moths of Epyrimenioidea, and the three obscure superfamilies of Scriseristinioidea, Uludoidea, and Galacticoidea. The largest clade, and the one relevant for the rest of this video, is the Obtectomera. This group is itself distinguished from the others by genetic data, as opposed to morphological features, because frankly, at this level, they're so diverse, it's very hard to distinguish one from the other. This clade is itself divided into seven groups, the first being the Wallianoidea, which consists of two obscure species endemic to the island of Madagascar that are nearly completely unknown and barely have any photos on the internet. Then there are the window-winged moths of the Thyridoidea, the flutworm moths of Capromorphoidea, which are found worldwide as pests, except for in the northwest of Europe. There are the Hyblaeoidea, another obscure group of moths often called beak moths. Then there is the obscure Emioidea, which are a group of colorful, though sadly obscure moths, known often as conifer moths and feed on conifers of the genus Podocarpus. Then there are the snout moths of the Pyraloidea, which are a massive group of over 16,000 species. The last group is the Macrolepidoidea, which includes all the remaining moths and probably all the moths you recognize, and will be the remainder of this video. It is itself divided into seven superfamilies. First is the Mimaloidea, also called the sack-bearing moths for their larvae that have case-building behavior. There are over 300 species, mostly in Central and South America. Next, we see the Lasiocampoidea, the lappet moths, named after the decorative skin flaps that our caterpillars have. There are over 2,000 species worldwide. Then there are the Bombycoidea, which include the silk moths, sphinx moths, luna moths, and isle moths, with over 2,700 species all over the world. Next, there are the Drepanoidea, also called the hooktip moths, with around 330 species, mostly in the tropics of the world. Then there are the Calidiluoidea, referred to as the Old World butterfly moths, which are so called for their similarity and relatedness to true butterflies. They are restricted to Southeast Asia, Australia, and Madagascar, and number 20 or so species. They're not that diverse. Then there are the Geometroidea, which includes more than 24,000 described species, such as emerald moths. But it is with the last superfamily we finally reach a group which includes the gypsy moths, and will be the subject for the remainder of this video. This final group are the Nocturoidea, often called owlet moths, is the largest superfamily in all of Lepidoptera, with more than 70,000 described species and many more likely to be described. There are, in general, somewhat drab moths, though many are quite colorful and can rival any butterfly, and just overall would be impossible to discuss this group in its entirety, but to keep it brief, it is divided into seven families. First, there are the Scrancidae, which are a group of obscure moths found in South Africa, Southeast Asia, and Northern Australia. Second, there are the Eutelidae, another little-known moth group that is filled with, honestly, mostly relatively bland moths, like the Adultratrix moth. Third, there is the Oensandridae, which are another small group of mysterious moths known from Australia. Fourth, there is the Nolidae, often called tough moths, which are distinguished by having silk cocoons with a distinct ventral exit slip. There are around 1,700 described species. Fifth, there are the Notodontidae, often called puss moths or prominents. It is a decently large group with 3,800 described species. Most are frankly boring, gray, or brown, but of course, there are always exceptions, and some are colorful. Sixth are the family Nocturoidea, which the superfamily is named after. These, often called owlet moths, are a highly diverse group that includes cutworms and armyworms, most of which are relatively minor pests and relatively drab-colored, but again, some tropical species can actually look somewhat beautiful. The final and largest family is the one which we will see the subject of this video belongs to, the Eribidae, which is officially the largest family of Lepidopterans and includes an absolutely massive diversity of moths divided into 18 subfamilies, which, of course, we're going to cover as well. First, we got the Ahnya, more commonly known as the snouted tiger moths, distributed across the tropics and subtropics of the Old World. Then there is the Anobinae, a group distinguished as recently as 2005. Otherwise, a relatively drab, medium-sized group of moths. Then we got the highly diverse Boletobinae, and our highly active field of study as numerous new species are being discovered in that group all the time. Then there is the Eulepidontinae, which are drab moths distinguished by just some really obscure details of the genitalia that I don't want to get into right now. The Hypocalinae are a rather small collection of humble-looking moths found in Asia and North America. The Pangraptinae are another medium-looking group of moths in eastern United States and Southeast Asia. The Rinrulinae are a decently diverse subfamily of moths with distinct microsculpting of the proboscis. The Scolecampinae are a rather obscure group of moths found in the Americas, distinguished by sac-like tymphatic pockets and other aspects of their reproductive organs. Then there are the Tinolinae, which are a slightly controversial subfamily, most well known for their insane-looking caterpillars of the dice moth. I mean, seriously, those are crazy. Then there are the Hypendinae, which are is a decently sized group of esoteric moths found in Europe, Southeast Asia, and the Eastern United States. The Toxocaminae are the last super obscure subfamily and consist of a group of mostly bland-looking moths that are distinguished by primitive male genital claspers and are most common in the central plains of the U.S. and Europe. The remaining subfamilies are well known enough to have a decent amount of research as well as common names. First, there is the Orsinae, more commonly known as tiger moths, wasp moths, or in the Drabber species, lichen moths. There are over 11,000 species distinguished by a timbal organ on their thorax, which allows them to produce ultrasonic sounds used in mating and defense against predators. Much more humble are the Hermanae, often called litter moths due to their larvae feeding mostly on dead leaf litter and other plant material. The Hypinae are often called snout moths due to their distinct head shape and are most well known for their most famous species, known for feeding on the tears of animals, and they're found worldwide. Then there are the Eribinae, more well known as underwings, which consist of over 10,000 species and are most diverse in the tropics. Then there are the Scolohepterinae, often called piercing moths, due to their possession of proboscises that can be used to pierce the skin of fruits to feed on their juices. The Calpinae are a rather similar group and are often called biting moths for the ability of some species to pierce the skin of mammals to feed on their blood, like a mosquito. It is in the final subfamily that we see the topic of the rest of this video, the Lymantrinae, often called tussocked moths, and include over 25,000 species in about 350 genera. They are further divided into 7 tribes. And if you don't know what a tribe is, it's a classification rank that's above a genus but below a subfamily. First, there are the Arctornotrini, which are mostly boring pale white moths found in Europe and Southeast Asia. Then there are the Daplicini, a very small group found in Southeast Asia and China. Next, we see the diminutive tribe called the Lycomoni, which are distinguished by asymmetric genitalia and are reddish on the underside of the head and thorax. The Localoinae are another obscure group that are frankly rather generic looking, all things considered. Then there are the Oniginae, which are a large group which have bushes of hair like pencils on their larvae. The Nigimi are a tribe that is also rather large and is distinguished by the adult females who have tufts of scales and use these to protect their eggs. The final tribe are called the Lymantrinae and are the ones that contain the topic of this video and which gave the subfamily the name it has for good reason. This tribe is divided into around 12 genera. The most notable one is Lymantria, which itself in Latin means destroyer, and for good reason. Of the over 150 species known, many are known to be nuisances, like the nun moth, Lymantria monaca. But of these, one stands above all in its infamy, Lymantria dispar, or the Gypsy Moth. Gypsy Moth, Gypsy Moth, oh, 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 Gypsy Moth, just flying from one light to another. It's the Gypsy Moth, flying all around and having fun, flying and looking for a light. The gypsy moth is itself, of course, divided into three subspecies. First is Lymantria dispar japonica, or the Japanese gypsy moth. This subspecies, which, true to its name, is found on the four main islands of Japan, and is distinguished by a very dark brown general coloration with larger-than-average males. Unlike the other two subspecies, it appears that they have not become invasive outside of their native range, though. Obviously, given the right conditions, they also could become an issue. Then there is the second subspecies, Lymantria dispar asiatica, or the Asian gypsy moth. This subspecies is distinguished by how females are capable of flight, unlike the other two subspecies, which, while females do have wings, they are completely flightless, aka they have no muscles and so they can't really fly. This species is native to the temperate areas of Asia, east of the Ural Mountains, up into the far east of Russia, and as far into the south as China and Korea. It has been found sporadically in western United States, especially in the Pacific Northwest. Luckily, perhaps due to learning lessons from the next species which shall be discussed, these invasions have largely been negligible and been stamped out rather quickly. But the fact remains that this subspecies has females that can fly, meaning they are arguably an even bigger threat that must be vigilant for. As we shall see, the third subspecies has been devastating. Lymantria dispar, known as the European gypsy moth, or, given that it's the one people often know about, just the gypsy moth. Let us discuss the general biology of this moth now that I've done all the taxonomy that's been leading up to this point. The gypsy moth begins life as one egg in a cluster that can contain anywhere from 100 to 1,000 individuals. These masses can be found in any sheltered area, including branches, trunks, rocks, foliage, shipping containers, and even vehicles. The eggs are covered in hair, which is believed to protect them from predators, parasites, and are even believed to play a role in insulating the eggs, which can survive being frozen. Some describe these egg cases as being spongy, but such can be said of nearly every other species in this genus, so it's not really a distinct trait. In color, this egg mass can vary from a dull yellow akin to manila paper to bleach white. The caterpillars emerge en masse in the spring, and from there they disperse and begin feeding on the leaves of trees and other plants. It is here we see a trait that causes them to stick out and gives them a lot more flexibility. Most caterpillars you see feed on a single plant or a small group of related plants, like the famous monarch, which feeds only on milkweed plants. However, the gypsy moth caterpillars can consume over 300 species of trees and shrubs, which we'll discuss later, meaning that they are quite flexible. They initially feed primarily in the morning and late afternoon, but as they grow larger, they become increasingly nocturnal more and more. Speaking of growing, the caterpillars grow and shed their skin through a series of instars. Males go through 5, while females go through 6 of these. They are characterized by a large number of irritating hairs that dissuade predators from eating them, though similar to the caterpillars of some native species, like those of the mourning cloak butterfly and tent caterpillars, they can be distinguished by 5 pairs of blue spots on the head and 6 red spots near the tail. The caterpillars can, in addition to traveling on their own, are able to secrete silk threads that are able to catch a breeze and cause them to be sent sort of floating through the air. The larvae reach maturity between mid-June and early July when they enter into the pupal stage. This pupation can take place under flaps of bark, in crevices, under branches, on the ground, and even other places. Usually the caterpillar create flimsy cocoons made up of a few silk strands holding some leaves together, while in some cases the cocoons hang from a tree bark akin to a butterfly, like a stalk. After a period of 14 to 17 days, the cocoons hatch into their adult forms. You can tell the difference between the two genders in that males have feathery antennae, while the females have thin ones and are slightly larger at 31 to 35 millimeters or 1.381 inches long. Females release pheromones in a process called calling that will attract the males, which use their larger antennae to find them. From there, the two have a simple courting mechanism where the females raise its wings to allow the males to engage in intercourse. Usually, this lasts for about 10 minutes, but in some cases, the two can go at it for as long as an hour. In either case, lacking a digestive system, the adult moths can only live for at most a week before they die. From this explanation of their biology, you might consider them a slightly forgettable, if adaptable, species. But let us just say that while on the surface that might be the case, this little fella has cast a long shadow over the eastern United States.
Oh, the gypsy moth is a mighty high flyer sailing on an inland sea. You are the object of my desire, you're the sun and the moon to me. And I believe in loving you, know that you keep me from feeling blue. Hey, you make me happy when everything I do gets me in trouble.
The start of this story begins with the otherwise obscure Entin Liebhold Trouvelot, who was a French artist, astronomer, and amateur entomologist. In a period of brief interest in entomology, he sought to solve an issue of how various silk-producing native moths used for silk production during the time were dying to an unknown illness that still hasn't really been identified. He imported some of the gypsy moths to try and create a domestic source of silk, which on paper seems like a fine idea, at least with the knowledge at the time. Unfortunately, it seems that the unexpected happened and some larvae managed to escape their enclosure and went into the nearby woods. There are conflicting records of what exactly happened next. Some say that Trouvelot warned the local officials, but they showed no interest in helping regain these moths. Other sources claim that he made no effort to tell them. Maybe communications broke down to his heavy French accent. In either case, he eventually faded into obscurity, but the gypsy moths he introduced, sadly, did not. In just 10 years, they had already reached notable levels in the state of Massachusetts, with the first major plague-level outbreak in 1889 throughout all of the New England states. Even at this early time, they were so numerous that hundreds of trees were defoliated. The caterpillars covered houses and sidewalks, raining down upon residents. The sound of their chewing was so loud, it was described as being akin to moderate rainfall. It has, as of 2021, established itself throughout the northeastern United States, having spread into Michigan, Minnesota, Virginia, West Virginia, Illinois, and Wisconsin, with reports as far out as Tennessee and Alabama. It has also gone into southern Quebec and Ontario in Canada. It has been estimated that the species has consumed over 1 million acres of forest each year. Indeed, their hunger knows no bounds, being seen to consume many, many species of trees and shrubs. This includes many species of oaks, aspens, apples, sweet gums, speckled alder, basswood, gray and paper birch, poplar, willow, hawthorns, ash, tulip trees, cucumber trees, American sycamore, butternut, black walnut, catalpa, flowering dogwoods, balsam fir, cedar, American holly, mountain laurels, Rhodesia, cottonwoods, hemlock, Atlantic white cypress, pine, and spruce trees. Not only in many cases does this outright kill the trees, but even if it doesn't, it can significantly weaken them to other pests or diseases like armillaria fungus or borer beetles. This loss of leaf cover leads to forest-dwelling birds having a higher rate of being exposed and hunted by predators, leading to an up to 60% population decrease. The caterpillars can be lethal to the northern tiger swallowtails if they're exposed to them, being outright lethal to the caterpillars. In addition, the caterpillars can give humans really bad rashes, not just by direct contact, but even by hairs being carried by the wind. It is especially bad for those with asthma, like myself. Now, while yes, it does seem all doom and gloom, it must be stressed that these animals are nowhere near as invincible, especially compared to some other invasive species like red-eared sliders or cane toads. In fact, individually, they're rather weak. Firstly, extended low temperatures can be fatal to the caterpillars. Second, quite a number of animals can consume them, including many birds like the blue jay, red-eyed vireo, and European robins. In addition, several small mammals like the white-footed mouse and northern short-tailed shrew consume them. Many invertebrates also feed on them in two ways, either directly feeding on them, as is the case with many spider species and the forest caterpillar hunter beetle, or as parasites. Parasites, for the record, are animals that feed on other creatures in a harmful manner. Parasitoids outright kill their hosts. That's how you distinguish from a parasite to a parasitoid. And there are quite a number that feed on the gypsy moth, including taconid flies, enricetid wasps, braconid wasps, calidid wasps, ichuminoid wasps, euplenoid wasps, and terimenid wasps. In addition, funguses like Eutromagia magiana, as well as bacteria like Enterococcus faecalis and viruses like the LDMNPV. So there is actually some hope here. Despite this, the gypsy moth has shown itself true to its Latin name, to be a destroyer, and due to its influence has left quite the impact on culture and the minds of humanity. The first usage of gypsy moth in the context of human culture was a 1920s D-60 biplane that was used throughout the 1920s up until the start of World War II, where it was used in various roles in Britain. They seem to have been fairly well made and very useful, though it eventually would be replaced by the Delta V-11 and DH-82 tiger moths. Keeping in line with vehicles, then there was a series of vehicles named after the animal. Gypsy Moth 1 was an aeroplane, then there were three yachts, Gypsy Moth 2, Gypsy Moth 3, and finally, most recently, Gypsy Moth 4, which noted British sailor Sir Francis Charles used to single-handedly sail around the world. The first person to do so all by themselves. Going to the more fictional side of culture, first we see the 1955 novel, The Gypsy's Moth. From what I can tell, it was a perfectly fine novel with some decent reviews, but really there was little information. In fact, the only copy I could see online that I could have possibly bought was a re-release made to celebrate / capitalize on the movie, which follows the basic plot of the novel, so let's shift to that now, because frankly, from what I can tell, the original novel is actually somewhat forgettable, sadly, and there really doesn't seem to be any online copy that I could have read, really. The movie adaptation was released in 1969 and was directed by noted film and television director John Michael Frankenheimer and had the notable movie stars Burt Lancaster, Deborah Kerr, and Bonnie Bedelia Culkin in her first film role. The film sees a trio of skydivers and their effect on a small American town in the American Midwest. It had a fairly good story, but does end on a somewhat depressing note, which I don't want to spoil you that, so. Despite having only a limited run, it seems to have bombed in the US and got mixed reviews, but it was strangely popular in Australia, which is, as you know, home of Shrimp on the Barbie. There is also a small indie band named the Gypsy Moths, located in Boston, Massachusetts. In Marvel Comics, a supervillainess under the name of Gypsy Moth showed up in 1979 during Spider-Woman Volume 1, Number 10. And yes, because I always mention Legos in these videos, in 1998, Lego released a sub-theme of space called the Insectoids that saw a race of aliens known as the Zotaxians, who rode vehicles that were insect-like in build. They were led by a blue-skinned queen named Gypsy Moth. In addition to appearing in two of the best sets of the theme, she also participated in the video game Lego Racers as a noteworthy opponent. As you can see here, the Gypsy Moth has had a great impact on the culture of the world. Surely it would not be controversial at all in any way. Oh no.
So dance into these gypsy tunes. He came upon a dark cocoon, a citadel spun out of gloom, where a lady cried she'd gone inside, a wingless child unknowing she was only growing.
Okay, so first off, Nick Anderson, that character was named after an animal, not a slur. I know you prefer to virtue signal on Twitter as opposed to actually do anything of substance to further help autistic people, but the name is in line with that of the other characters in the theme. I highly doubt Lego, one of those politically correct companies to exist, would name a character after a slur. But to get more broad and serious, this controversy began in July 2021 when the Entomological Society sought to rename names that were arbitrarily deemed as being offensive. It was not the only insect whose name was changed during the time. There was also the otherwise obscure gypsy ant. Now, I want to stress that this society is more of a bureaucratic organization as opposed to a group of actual scientists of any value. Most do not engage in active research or field studies, and they really don't have any actual authority on what words people are allowed to say. Basically, it's a glorified collection of bloggers, but even if they did have authority, their decision is frankly kind of stupid. The reasons that they did this are dumb, because they claim that the gypsy moth is named after a slur that is offensive to Romani people. But this is actually incorrect. The gypsy moth was given its name due to the fact that, unlike most related moth species, the gypsy moth wanders around. It's not, like, sedentary. And it's not because they were using the name in a demeaning term to the Romani. Also, the Romani community is far from united against this word. For example, the English and Welsh Romani branches regularly use the term in both informal and formal documentation. And let us be frank, that there are far more pressing issues facing the community of the Romani as opposed to this silly name. Also, technically speaking, if you wanted to go intersectional, you could point out the fact that the Romani are white and therefore do not face actual oppression, but I don't believe that argument. And even if one wants to say that a replacement name was absolutely needed, the chosen new name, Spongy Moth, is just dumb. It's named after their egg case, which allegedly looks like a sponge, but first off, they don't really look like sponges, and the fact is that nearly every species in the genus has eggs like that. In fact, many unrelated genera moths have similar egg cases. Overall, the whole messy manufacturing is stupid, and I'll put some links in the description if you want to learn more. Just use the gypsy moth if you want. It doesn't really matter. These moral busybodies have no authority and really no value to them. In conclusion, whatever name you give it, the gypsy moth, despite its lowly appearance, has left a huge impact upon both humanity and the environment of the eastern United States. Regardless of whether the name is controversial, I hope you enjoy this video. I know that some of these one-off documentary-type videos rarely do well compared to my other series. If you enjoyed it, consider giving it a watch, subscribe, and have a wonderful day. If people want, I can do more of these. I'll be definitely willing to talk about more groups of animals. And if you enjoyed it, you know, tell me, leave a comment. Comments are always helpful when offering me feedback.